Loving gracious Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord Jesus, for all the blessings, Lord, each and every blessing that we know and many of which we are unaware of, which you have bestowed in our lives, especially in this last 1 year. Thank you, Lord, for keeping us safe and healthy so that we can still gather like this and praise your name, praise your holy name. Thank you, Lord. We praise you. Thank you for all your mercies, Lord. Immeasurable, immense, and Lord, invaluable and beyond number, innumerable. Father, thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for all your thoughts for us, Lord. Even more than in number than the sand on the earth are your thoughts for us as we read in your word. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your care for us. Lord, you know you have even numbered the hairs on our head. Nothing can happen to us without your knowledge and permission. Of course, Lord, even as many people have endured so many hardships in this last 1 year, nothing has happened without your knowledge and permission. And Lord, your promise is that you will make everything to work together for our very good, for our very best, to make us more like Christ, which is the eternal good that you have planned for us. Yes, Father, thank you. We want to raise the cup of salvation and give thanks to your name. Holy be your name. Thank you, Jesus. And even as we come before you to hear your word, Lord, it is your word and you are the one who has inspired the word, and you alone can reveal to us the mysteries of your word in such a way that it can be spiritually edifying to us and spiritually profitable to us from an eternity perspective. Lord, we do not just want to gather some knowledge, but Lord, we want to hear your voice and we want to be transformed. Lord, we want to humble ourselves and give ourselves as a living sacrifice unto you. Cleanse our hearts with your blood and flood our hearts with your Holy Spirit. And Lord, help us to behold your face in the mirror of your word and be encouraged and be transformed. In Jesus' precious, sweetest name we pray. Amen. Amen. So, we have been thinking of the book of Hebrews. We have been meditating from the book of Hebrews over the last so many weeks, and we have come to chapter 3, and we saw how Jesus came as a man just like us so that he can be a forerunner, he can be a perfect example for us. He has walked this way of sufferings, that is a way of perfection, and he has gone ahead of us. Like Hebrews 2:10 says, in bringing many sons to glory, to perfect the order of their salvation through sufferings. And he has conquered death. Hebrews 2:14, through Jesus' death, Jesus rendered powerless the devil who had the power of death. Jesus has rendered the devil powerless as far as we are concerned, the children of God are concerned. And we saw that it was through Jesus' suffering and death that he overcame Satan. Satan, the angel, Lucifer, as we commonly know him, Lucifer became the devil by exalting himself and becoming proud and discontent and rebellious. And the salvation, so sin came through pride and rebellion and discontentment. And salvation came through humbling, Jesus humbling himself. And he humbled himself to the point of death. And if we also go through that same path of death to self, we can also overcome Satan. That's a very great paradox. Many people say about spiritual battles and overcoming the devil and all, they are kind of, using their physical fist, and they are praying loud, and you know, there are many meetings in which the so-called pastors and preachers will be shouting loud to cast out the demons and all. So but actually, to if we have Jesus' authority, we do not have to shout loud or anything. We just need to tell the devil, I command you in the name of Lord Jesus Christ to come out of that person and leave. because he has already been defeated, and we can overcome the devil if we can humble ourselves to the utmost and keep a good conscience before the Lord, and the Lord can empower us with the Holy Spirit and give us power to overcome the devil, not only to cast out demons, which many may not be called to do, but we can overcome Satan in our lives, in our with respect to the temptations that we face every day, with respect to the trials that we face every day. Devil will be firing the fiery missiles of condemnation and discouragement and blasphemy and so many things, and to extinguish those fiery missiles of the evil one, as we read in Ephesians 6:17-18, we have the shield of faith, where we trust and believe in our loving Father, who knows everything, without whose permission nothing can happen, and we can overcome him by faith, the shield of faith. We helplessly depend, the faith is that helpless, poor, childlike, faith is that childlike, helpless dependence and confidence in the Lord, as Balzac says. So if we, as a helpless babe, if we humble ourselves and lean on to the Lord can empower us with the Holy Spirit, and perfect love casts out all fear. 1 John 4:18 says, perfect love casts out fear. So if our heart is full of the love of the Lord, all the fear would be displaced from our heart. Just like if a cup is full of water, all the air will be displaced. The air can be compared to the negative emotions, whether it be fear or anxiety or jealousy or murmuring or complaining or whatever negative emotions, judgmentalism or whatever. If our heart is full of the love of the Lord by the Holy Spirit, then all the negative emotions will be driven out of our heart. And like that, through that death to self only, we can be full of the Holy Spirit. By dying to ourselves, by emptying ourselves and humbling ourselves to the point of zero before the Lord, when we acknowledge ourselves to be a zero before the Lord, then the Lord can fill us with the power of the Holy Spirit and help us to overcome the devil in our lives, in our family, in our church, and wherever the Lord wants us to exercise that authority. The Lord can help us. Through death, the devil was rendered powerless. Hebrews 2:14. And then Hebrews 3, we were seeing how we need to consider Jesus at every point of time. We have only one dictionary as far as spirituality is concerned. To look at the meaning of any word, the spiritual meaning of any word. For example, humility. If you look at the dictionary meaning, you will get a meaning. But only if you look at Jesus carefully and you are enlightened by the Holy Spirit, then only you will know the true meaning of what humility is, what true meekness is, what true honesty is, what true faithfulness is. Jesus is the dictionary. He is the Word became Word made flesh. John 1:14. He Word became flesh, and that was Jesus. And there in Hebrews 3:1, holy brethren, partakers of a heavenly calling, and we need to consider Jesus. We need to look carefully at this Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, as we read in the last chapter of this, second last chapter, Hebrews 12:1-2. Fix your eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher. So our inner eyes should be focused on the Lord, and that can happen only if we humble ourselves continually and are filled with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit can guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, it says in Philippians 4:7. And the peace of God, when we make known to God all the requests, all the cares and worries and anxieties with prayers and supplications with thanksgiving, and then Philippians 4:6 says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything with prayers and supplications. Supplication means specific requests. With prayers and specific requests, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Whatever requests you have, whatever worries or anxieties, even at this end of this year, whatever worries or anxieties you have about the next year, everything we make known to God, and the peace of God shall, peace of God that surpasses all understanding, will guard your minds, hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. That is what Philippians 4:7 says. So it is actually The peace of God is through the Holy Spirit. Peace, Holy Spirit, the fruit of the Holy Spirit is love, joy, peace. So Holy Spirit floods our heart with love, Romans 5:5. Holy Spirit floods our hearts with joy, and the Holy Spirit floods our hearts with peace. And that peace that surpasses all understanding, which is beyond our understanding, which is beyond our reason, even in the despite the most difficult circumstances, we can have a peace which God alone can give, not any psychology or any mind power techniques, or nothing can give that peace that surpasses all understanding. Only Jesus alone can give that peace, and that peace will guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Meaning, you know, our hearts and minds won't be restless, it would be guarded by the peace of God, that is the Holy Spirit giving us that peace, filling our hearts. And just like if a vessel is empty, it will make much noise, but if the vessel is full, it won't make sound. No, so like that, our heart would be at rest, heart would be full of the peace of God, and our heart would be at rest. Jesus says, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, I'll give you rest. That theme of rest will come in the subsequent portion in Hebrews chapter, latter part of Hebrews chapter 3 and Hebrews chapter 4, and all entering that rest. So when we consider Jesus, he will guard our hearts and minds, and the Holy Spirit alone can help us to fix our inner eyes on the Lord. Holy Spirit will guard our hearts and minds fixed on Jesus. And that is not just by reminding ourselves mechanically by any reminders or anything, but the Holy Spirit will remind us. Holy Spirit will make us conscious of the presence of God all the time. Practicing the presence of God, a book by Brother Lawrence is there, one classic book of which is a compilation of many letters written by a 17th century Catholic monk who was just a cook in a Catholic monastery. Whose real name is Nicholas Osso, and he is commonly known as Brother Lawrence. And he is telling in his book how he sensed the presence of God even while there was so much of clamor in the kitchen, and even while so many people will be demanding so many things from the other room, he will be having as much calmness in his mind as he would have when he would receive the Lord's table, the bread from the Lord's Supper. So that much calmness he would be having even in the clamor of the kitchen. That means that he was such a broken man that he was full of the Holy Spirit. He wouldn't have had the right theology, but he had the right knowledge of God through the Holy Spirit. Would have been so full of the Holy Spirit that he was able to experience God's presence wherever he was, because he would have always cast all his cares. In his book, if you read, it is freely downloadable from the internet. If you search Practicing the Presence of God, Brother Lawrence, you will get the PDF file, and it has blessed me many a time, actually. You know, his experiences, he is saying, where he would pray to the Lord, he would be conversing with the Lord Jesus throughout his day, even during the chores of his life, mundane routine things of his life, he would be conversing with Jesus in his heart, and he would be casting all his cares unto the Lord, and the peace of God would guard his heart. So that can be our experience too, in a progressive manner, if we too consider Jesus, learn to consider Jesus. And we can only, if we humble ourselves, we can cast all our burdens unto the Lord. You know, 1 Peter 5:7 says, cast your cares unto the Lord because he cares for you. But 1 Peter 5:6, just the previous verse says that, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, that he might exalt you at the proper time, casting your burdens unto the Lord, casting all your anxiety unto the Lord because he cares for you. It's one sentence, actually. Only if you really humble yourself, you can really cast all your cares unto the Lord. Otherwise, even if you try to cast all your cares, the cares would be there upon you yourself. Just like somebody said, take your, famous hymn is there, no? Take it to the Lord in prayer. So, many times we take it to the Lord in prayer, After the prayer, we take it back from the Lord and carry around. That is what usually happens. But if we humble ourselves and acknowledge that, Lord, I am nothing, we'll be able to take it to the Lord in prayer and cast it onto the Lord and not take it back. Through many failures and disappointments in our lives, the Lord would be breaking our own self-confidence, that we would finally learn a lesson progressively that, Lord, I can do nothing of myself. Just like Jesus said in John 15:5, apart from me, you can do nothing. So when we learn that lesson more and more in our lives and realize that there is nothing good that dwells in our flesh, Romans 7:18, and then we would be crying out to the Lord in that helpless dependence like a little child and say that, Lord, you lead me, you guide me. And then the Lord will flood our hearts with his peace and his joy.